is the only public broadcaster of choice.
We inform, educate, guide, and entertain.
We're bringing news as it is, wherever it is happening, in real time.
We take you far away places, from border to border.
We keep you up to date wherever you are.
In the languages of Kiswahili, Luganda,
and English.
UBC TV,
inspiring Uganda.
With the best mid-morning entertainment. We bring you the latest in showbiz.
He actually has already asked me for hand in marriage way before I was even pregnant.
Topical issues.
So, as I told you, I want to become a business tycoon. Maybe I'll start with a restaurant.
Yeah.
Fashion, tech and gadget news, and your countdown. Join us Monday to Thursday, 10 a.m. Jam 101. We set the pace.
Talking about the best, I said my name is Invoke. Yeah.
We're back in GMU Agenda. Now, in our first interview, we shall be looking at civil society and their contribution to electoral processes in Uganda, but also at the greater level of Africa. Now, in studio with me, I have Mr. Kambura.
Thank you, sir. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm happy to be here again.
It is indeed a pleasure to have you again in our studio, and particularly in Good Morning Uganda.
Well, thank you.
And of course, today we are here to discuss basically civil society and its contribution towards the electoral democracy, election processes, vis-a-vis the government and also the civil sector.
Oh, yes.
Maybe for our viewers, to kickstart this discussion, we need to understand what would one define as civil society, per se?
A civil society organization, just like NGOs, they also operate to promote civic education, basically, from the word civil, you know, civic education, to educate the local people the importance of elections and going to vote, responsibilities and rights, and making sure they become a development partner of government. But in this case, majority of these civil society organizations in the context of Africa, they have turned themselves into another opposition political party, literally based on the current research and the report that has just come out indicate that most of them actually are pushing government to, of course, account, which is okay, but also bending to be actually partisan when they are not supposed to be partisan nature.
Okay, so we must understand that at least a civil society must only be made to desist from partisan politics in that particular matter.
Exactly.
Now, this particular discussion is also limited to the Great Lakes region.
Yes.
Now,
yes.
Our viewer would also want to know that when we talk about the Great Lakes region, what are we calling onto ourselves? What is the Great Lakes? What countries are considered to be in the Great Lakes region? Our discussion.
When it comes to the Great Lakes region, we have all the countries that build. We are talking about Uganda is part of the Great Lakes region. We are talking about DRC, Democratic Republic of Congo. We are talking about Rwanda, Burundi. We are talking about Tanzania. So basically, the Great Lakes region is that kind of valley that has all the waters. These waters of ours in Lake Victoria, Lake Bunyonyi, this region, Kenya, you know, all these countries.
Okay.
Yeah.
Having understood the Great Lakes region, the civil society, it would also be important that you also know what are the basic roles of civil society? Because most of the times, as you said, that we have a confusion between them being political parties.
Yeah.
This normally comes into play because they act like they are parties in seeking for accountability, both for finances, governance, rule of law, and all these things. So what is the role of civil society ideally?
Basically, there are four principal things here. We are talking about, for example, in the context of elections, which I'm going to use as an example.
Okay.
Like, for example, I have just been in the Democratic Republic of Congo, meeting presidential candidates and other leaders, religious leaders. In that context, civil society organizations are supposed to go to the grassroots and educate the local people in villages the advantages of going to vote for a candidate they love. That is the work of a civil society organization. So that people are educated on their civic liberties, civil rights and responsibilities. That yes, you are supposed to pay tax. The advantages of paying tax, because government will have resources to build your road and hospital. Then they say, if you go to vote, then there can be transparency. There can be transparent elections, because all candidates will have their people voting for them. But then it comes the other story, where they don't want to go to the grassroots, to now only focus on pinching government, that please, we want accountability. You have misused the money. You have, you know, so they have two roles. They have to balance the equation by making sure they are at the grassroots to educate the farmers, our people, that hey, you pay taxes so that government has money. When they pay tax, therefore, you can now push government to actually produce accountability to the taxpayer. During elections, you find the only focus, for example, in DRC, what I've seen is they're only focusing on writing stories in newspapers, going to the television, of course, which is okay, and writing on social media negative things about Congo. But they forget that the Democratic Republic of Congo is a nation that deserves fairness. It's not a playground of conflict only. And then violence has sparked up because of the negative information that is being spread both locally in the region and international about a certain candidate, maybe about the country. So they say we can't trust the electoral commission, we can't trust the system they have put in play. So civil society organizations become actually a negative force when they are supposed to follow the act. Like now in Uganda we have the NGO Act, which actually guides the operations to become a non-partisan force. But look here, they are supposed to not only become partisan, which is very bad, but they go ahead to actually give resources to one political party. They say, we are working with candidate X, whom we want to be a president of DRC. Then they give such a person a lot of money. Then they become non-partisan. Then when the elections are going on, of course, they are hiding behind. You can't track them. They are working through different banks, different candidates, different systems. You can't know that this is organization X. But whatever confusion is in the country is actually built and initiated, established and supported by civil society organizations. In the name of civil society.
And now, Milton, in relation to what you just said, you see, I'll bring it back home here. Most of the times we have had a conflict of understanding the role of what would be civil society. For example, we have had a number of NGOs that are tasked with looking at electoral democracy and electoral fairness. Now, there was a time, I think, whether was it SEDU was banned.
From
being an observer.
Yes.
Particularly, because I didn't see it in Arua, I didn't see it in Jinja, I didn't see it. And is there a point where, in my opinion, government has fallen short of proper accountability and it has hid under the niceties of saying civil society is being partisan? For example, when you talk about election rigging, malpractice of election, ballot staffing, and there's evidence.
Yes, please.
When you look at the case of Dr. Kizza Besigye versus His Excellency, the President, and the Electoral Commission, that particular petition, the presidential electoral petition, the grounds that court raised said that, yes, there was. The NGOs had reported that, yes, there were. But yet, of course, the ruling was that it wasn't persuasive enough, which was a very good ruling. But those kind of evidence, don't you think that sometimes the reason why we say NGOs or civil society is partisan because government is actually scared of accountability or it has no accountability? When you look at the corruption, and you look at the NGOs that are speaking about corruption and what. Do you think it is the civil society that is wrong or the government for that matter?
You realize that we are supposed to be equal partners in this game.
Definitely.
We got not to say Mr. Milton or Mr. X is coming as a force in the name of civil society organizations to make the electoral process difficult. Because sometimes we have predetermined mind, because there are certain foreign interests. Yeah. There are certain foreign objectives. Even if you organize the transparent election, when one has gotten a predetermined mind, of course, for the Chintu Kidogo, you know Chintu Kidogo, I must, after elections, I must have finished building a 5-story infrastructure in the city of Kampala. And then a deal comes, say, we want, there are already predetermined objectives. And
there's
one
intention.
Wants to get, it is intention. Sometimes you want to just fulfill a certain force that is not friendly to Uganda. You must show, for example, they say you must show that the elections were actually rigged. Even before elections are organized. Certain people have those interests. For them, they want to actually decampaign. Kind of frustrate the good name of the country and its and the progress of different stakeholders. So I'm not attacking the civil society organizations because I'm part of them, because I'm part of government, because I'm part of the private sector. But I am non-partisan on this station. But I'm only saying that must stop. For example, the question you have just said is what I saw in this region. We are talking about using the latest technology, for example.
That is in Congo.
Exactly. Okay. In Congo.
Yes.
Because we have seen when you have technology, results come from the field very fast. The traditional lining up and all these things made in one way or the other actually accelerate conflict in the communities. You are aware about those challenges.
Yeah.
Now, within the technological advancement, which many nations are actually using and adopting, you find civil society organizations, for example, in DRC, they are advocating for the other traditional method of kind of voting. Why do they know the implication? Because they are aware of the conflict early warning mechanism, which already shows that there are going to be too much violence, too much death of people, there's going to be too much cheating, because of course traditional.
Yes.
Someone will vote in this village. This is which village? Nakasero village?
Mm-hmm.
The UBC, yes, in Nakasero village.
Yes.
Then you find after voting he goes to Ntinda. Mm. Because there is no even photos, nothing. People just, they will just kind
for
of
records.
Reach because there is no technology.
Mm.
But they educated, they intentionally fail to educate the local people that, hey, you guys, we got to adopt to the latest technology. Even then, both could have some disadvantage and advantage.
Yes.
Of course, there is nothing.
But it is a better option.
But it's a better option.
Mm.
The internet can be beefed up in the forests of DRC. Computers can be mapped up. Technology can be put in place even in 1 month.
Yeah.
But look, we are talking about the traditional method of voting in a big country of more than 70 million people.
Okay. Now.
Yes. So it has a challenge.
Definitely.
So the option would be using and advocating for increased budget to the Electoral Commission to be able to educate the local people on how to adopt,
yeah,
to technology.
Technology, yes.
That would be one of the mechanisms.
Mm.
But look here, there is also the other problem where we see civil society organizations sponsoring opposition political parties to go to Geneva. You are aware, 10 political parties went to Geneva. They are funded. The Felix Tshisekedi and his group, the opposition leaders, they are taken to Geneva to select among themselves one candidate,
yes, yes,
to fight the other candidate of FCC, mm, of Kabila.
Mm.
Yes, that could be a good perspective to some people. But to the growth of democracy in Africa, to the growth and the building block and the capacity processes of political parties, which these Bazungu brought. They brought this political dispensation. We must allow democracy to grow, to allow Mr. X, Mrs. X, Y, to stand amid this a peaceful environment,
yes, yes,
but not sponsoring one candidate.
Mm.
Basically, on their back of their mind, they know that they must frustrate the electoral process,
mm,
by bringing actually the weaker opposition political party, so that probably, you know, this is a game we are talking about again.
Yeah.
So we could have a challenge in Africa of civil society organizations becoming a negative development partner by being partisan, because why in the first place do you sponsor 10 political party leaders to go to Geneva to confuse them, to get out of a political process which is contentious, which has taken shape? Then you say, we want only one political, mm, candidate. So you are literally showing the government, mm, that for us,
we are
interested in the opposition. We are actually part of the opposition wanting to take over power. Who are you? The people must vote first. For you, you must sponsor all of them. If you're organizing a meeting, support all of them.
Mm.
If there is this thing of iPod, support all of them. We have the National Consultative Forum in Uganda, which is a constitutional framework that unites,
yes,
all political parties together, unite them. The dialogue in Uganda, the national dialogue,
mm,
has become another avenue of some people to actually look for money. Dialogue, if I want to dialogue with you, do I need a budget?
No, but well, that is Uganda for you.
Yes.
So some of these things are a bit, but of course I want us to look at, now, the findings of what we would call the civil society,
mm-hmm,
most of the times, some of these are research-based, others are field-based, mm-hmm, others have contact, others, mm-hmm, advocacy.
Mm-hmm.
How binding are the findings of these? Do you think they can influence change? have they influenced change in the past? And if so, do we have any examples? For example, I remember the last civil society consultative meeting that was there about constitutional.
Yes.
Constitutional amendments, constitutional suggestions on what should be. I mean, I think it was at, is it Africana?
Yeah, at Hotel Africana.
Africana, yes.
Yes.
A couple of suggestions were given. Yes. We had civil society, we had the elders, we had political parties.
Yes.
The challenge is, even when these civil societies mean good, have they been well received by government? That is a challenge, Milton.
The fact we must appreciate, brother, that's a very good question. And I like these hot questions. You see, when you're going into research, I studied research.
Mm.
You have to be neutral.
Yes.
You must be neutral free. Free. You must look like a pastor or a religious leader. Of course, these days they're also partisan.
Yeah, definitely. Most of them. Most
these
of
days
them.
Also.
Yes.
So, the research of this nature, which we are talking about, they have a predetermined mind. The research they want to conduct has already foreign interest.
Mm.
Now, such a research, the outcomes of and recommendations of such a research is banned.
Yes, and not free and fair.
And not free and fair. The fact that it is banned and predetermined
is already biased.
It's already biased. The outcomes, the recommendations, and its outcomes are already biased. So we got to have a non-partisan professional system, just like the United States government. Whenever I'm in the U.S., I try to read these people's research. The government has accepted some think tanks to be established, which are free of bias. The government actually funds them every year. That for us, we will put a lot of millions of dollars in this think tank. This think tank will become non-partisan.
Mm.
And whatever they research and the outcomes of the research, they are always taken like binding. People respect them all over the world. So, but here in Africa, even our governments have not put research on their budget.
And you have talked about that's the biggest. That's why we have every time we have laws being revisited. We have let us revisit. So because of this,
that is a very serious challenge. Mm. Look at the problem, the implication of two things in DRC, where I just came back and I'm going back next month to actually meet again these presidential candidates, religious leaders, and the members of the Chamber of Commerce. What I saw there is that civil society and other players were focusing on just frustrating Kabila, His Excellency Kabila, by making sure there is an article, of course, which was okay, that they do not want these term limits, basically. Mm. There are only two term limits. That was their main focus.
Yeah.
But brother, they did not, you see, when you are putting Y, you must put X to balance the equation. You were president, for example, today of a certain country, probably a country Y. Mm. They say term limits. There must be on this side on the column, what we call a presidential, presidential immunity act, which actually gives you, for example, the peace, you become a liability, like you don't have, you are free of indemnity.
Yes.
Which is in the United States. Mm. When President Bush attacked, of course, Junior, attacked Iraq, there are many mistakes that were made. Mm. Look at President Obama, there are many things that he said, if I could be given another chance, but the Constitution cannot allow.
No.
There are certain mistakes I did, A, B, C, D. Yeah. Yes, he made those mistakes. But tell you what, he's a free man.
Mm.
That was not accounting for the regime and its issues, all these to account to be taken to the ICC. Those were done in the name of government. The government will pay for those things.
Yeah, because,
but not exactly.
Yeah, because and that's the biggest stigma we have in Africa, that leaders are scared of what will be after.
Exactly.
Because they are not protected.
Exactly.
And that's a challenge that I think most of the Great Lakes leaders were. And even African Union have been arguing about the Rome Statute, the ICC, and its cruelty and how it's targeting black nations. For example, you look at the sanctions against Bashir. But Bashir has been so instrumental in reconstructing South Sudan.
Exactly.
So how does he paid for that? You know,
nobody's asking that. You
exactly.
Know?
Yes.
We young people, we can think.
Exactly. So.
And you're asking who can pay for that?
Yeah. Exactly. And so they are seeming to ignore this.
Yes.
As no contribution.
Exactly.
When you look at Muammar Gaddafi, who also had challenges and actually was later killed by NATO.
Exactly.
His contribution to the greater Africa was not even looked at, but only looked at. So I think this is quite important.
Very key.
And you see, when we call upon ourselves civil society as a country, sometimes it becomes hard to push it away.
So that is why, for the sake of peace, when you're in peace building, you know, this work is the most riskiest job in the world.
Yes.
You know, this one will hate you, the other one. So long as you keep telling them the truth.
You must have a win-win.
You must be able to help them compromise on some areas. Just like the political parties in Uganda here. I advise all of you to start learning how to compromise, not to just be rigid. Because peace is the most important ingredient of leadership, of a nation, of investment.
Yes.
So without peace, and how does peace come about? It's all about dialogue. It's all about saying, you love this, but you can leave it me so that I also achieve this. I will also leave this so that you achieve this. But for the sake of our country, we can move like this. So particularly in this era, where we are agitating for term limits, I urge the Parliament of Uganda and all parliaments in the region to actually put in place what we call the Presidential Immunity Act, so that a president, when he hands over power, is not hunted like a dog. Having built such a nation like Uganda, look at this country, where we came from. So it is primarily upon us to motivate our leaders to be able to hand over power peacefully, so that they can go home and live with their families peacefully, so that they can walk on the streets of Kampala without any indemnity, without any legal accountability.
But I think Kenya is doing it well. I've seen at least the likes of Kibaki have been well respected.
Yes.
And the previous head, also Tanzania.
Yes.
The only challenge that in Uganda we have a lot of political pressure and a lot of hatred. Politics has been the essence of intellectual debate has been substituted with violence and hate and too much Cold War, if I may use that word. But of course, back to civil societies, Milton, I would want to ask, here we are with civil societies. What is the way forward? How do we tap into the best point? Because civil society is a very big composure of the countries, both socio-economic, political, religious. You understand, all these are part of the civil society. But how do we go forward? How do we get out of this mess?
You are asking a very big question that requires the think tanks of this country. I don't know whether we have think tanks here. People, you see, the question you have just asked will take 2 years for some people here to answer. We have professors, they have not realized that this sector is the one influencing Africa.
Definitely.
People don't know where the virus is coming from. But as the civil society organizations, we are actually influencing laws in our countries.
Yeah.
Through hidden walls, which you cannot, in America we have the Washington walls, where people hide in others. They hide in others. I enter you, I give you a philosophy, I support you, you go and confuse the people. That's what is in Africa. You think people are talking and are sobbing in parliament, but they are pushing certain ideas which are actually primarily foreign in nature. They are not coming from the voters. So what are we talking about? We are talking about the dilemma of the private sector-led initiative. You know, civil society is part of the private sector.
Sure.
But look at the laws that is regulating civil society organizations. Very weak. Even the framework to even supervise the operations of NGOs, civil society organizations, is very weak in such a country.
Yeah.
So we even don't know where some of these elements are coming from. They are coming from certain forces, which I said, the Washington Walls. The Washington Walls mean you enter someone. Someone carries your spirit and your objectives. If I know government hates me, I will just be at my home. I bring Ruatoro. Ruatoro, I greet you. Then Ruatoro must become a good speaker to push my idea. For me, the one confusing the country, I am sitting somewhere. Nobody even knows me. Even we may be only talking on WhatsApp. Yeah, this will work. This will work. Please push it. Forget about your local people. Forget about your company. We are frustrating even investors. Now, to answer your question, I will bring you what we call the dilemma of understanding that civil society organizations are part of the private sector system. What are we supposed to do? Before I reach to what we are supposed to do, what are we doing now? Two, we are doing two things. Frustrating the name of the country in the name of self-survival. That everything must be problem statement. Uganda is a country confused. Then you talk that nonsense. You taint your country badly so that for you get money. So that for you, you attract the enemies of the country to come and support you and give you a budget. Uganda, DRC is a country even it is not supposed to be on the map. It is supposed, it is a failed nation. But look, every phone you have has an ingredient from Congo. Or that country is the richest in minerals in the world. Why can't you talk about the minerals, the culture, the people, the population, the youthful population, the energy that can stimulate economic development? But civil society organizations have only, they are talking bad about the country. Then that is frustrating investors from coming to invest in the country. That is a failed state. I can't take my money there. Even when they want to come and tap your minerals, the oil, they are scared. What are they doing? They are promoting foreign interests. And what are they doing? At the expense of countries' interests, countries' vision, countries' values. That's what we are doing, my brother. And that is meaning that we are partisan. We are even the one actually rising political parties, opposition political parties, to fight the regime in power. So, where do we get ourselves in dilemma? Now we have in Uganda, I congratulate the leaders. We have what we call the public order management, what? Bill, and which became a law. In countries like DRC, such a law is not there. How do you operate as a president? So becoming a president in that country is not easy, because you are not the president, actually. Everybody can become a president and rule a certain village, and rule a certain sector, influence the church, influence politics. So they will even assassinate you because they are in charge of the nation. They are confusing, they are bringing connotations, philosophies that are foreign in nature. So you cannot make a name, even your legacy. So what are we saying? We are saying that Kabila is handing over power. But what are the guarantees that he will not go into exile? Because then the next president, after seeing Kabila suffering, will change that law into saying no more term limit. Actually, term limit should go away because he saw Kabila suffering. So we should start, civil society organizations should focus on educating, on investing in non-partisan programs, going to the community, teaching people their responsibilities, their rights, which government, of course, would wish, because it helps government. If I go to a village X to teach people on how to pay tax, the importance of paying tax, on how to become a law-abiding citizen, and then government will listen to me when I say, please, corruption is not good. We want accountability. They will say, yeah, we need to work with these people because they balance the equation. So right now, what we can only do is to provide win-win solutions in a country.
Okay.
That is one. That, because you ask, what is our role? That is what we are supposed to do. Civic education. Then three, peace building is very key. We should become part and parcel of the development prospects of our country by even working to bring investors into the country. Because we are part of the private sector system. So in this case, when we are talking about peace, we are supposed to go to the community, organize community-driven development meetings. Educate people on how they can come together to solve their common challenges in the community. Then become a development partner, which government can actually appreciate because we are part of government. Everybody is part of government.
Definitely,
because government
definitely.
Is you and me.
And of course, every man is a political animal.
Exactly.
So, regardless of anything, political decisions affect every Ugandan. Now, just like lastly, Milton, maybe very, very, very briefly, there are a couple of challenges that Ugandans are facing. For example, and most recent and most common or most obvious are the issues of accountability.
Yes.
A couple of civil societies have come out to discuss these issues, to give reports. For example, sometime back we used to have these people that used to have Black Monday, and a couple of others have come out to talk about accountability. I would want to ask you this lastly and briefly, that don't you think that governments have hidden under the solace of failure to account to accuse civil society of being partisan? And we have very a million examples when it comes to Uganda in particular, that when you look at all these monies that have been failed to be given accountability of, and if a civil society came out to speak about it, they then would be considered to be partisan.
Oh, wow. You see, they told us, if you want to promote integrity, you know, I have an organization, I'm a founder of Integrity Uganda. They told me, if you want to promote integrity in Uganda, you yourself, you must first demonstrate ethical culture.
Yes.
The moment your hands are dirty, government will fear you. That's because government has infrastructure to know whom are we working with. We just concluded the Global Peace Leadership Conference 2018. You saw it?
Sure.
A huge milestone that attracted investors from all over the world. Even our local investors coming and mixing with those international investors and sharing the goodness of this country and opportunities, and many are flying in the country coming to invest. Religious leaders, education people, the teachers, the women, the president, the regional. Why did I, with my team, convince the government that this thing is good for the country? Because my hands are clean. The moment your hands are clean, government will work with you. Government has no problem with working with everybody. The issue of accountability which you are asking, yes, corruption is there. But what would be the role of civil society organizations? Having known that they are very intellectual people, they are educated people, people in civil society organizations, the NGOs, are highly educated. They are not kwara-kwara people. But they confuse. Most of them confuse. But what would be our role? Our role would be now knowing what is the source of corruption in this country, not just talking about it. Going to the family. The family is the source of all these issues. We know what to do. We know where the problem, the root cause of all these problems. But how many NGOs are organizing capacity building trainings for parents to make sure they nurture children who are going to be responsible, accountable, creative, entrepreneurial, innovative citizens of this country. Because it is the family where we come from. If Museveni gave me a job today and I became a good worker or a good manager of a certain ministry or a division, or who is that person that influenced me to be like that? It's my parents, my family. So we got to be sure that on one side we are doing the right thing, that we are helping government to not only pinpoint government and frustrate government and say, you guys, you have stolen our money, but to solve the problem from the root cause. Then from there, we also put programs to actually push government in a peaceful way that, look, Mr. Museveni, our president, these people are corrupt, and these are evidences. Already there is the office of the IGG. It is open. It has a department of these whistleblowers. Be a whistleblower. Go and recruit yourself. You will be even facilitated. Then you become part of the pillars of this country in terms of propelling accountability, ethical culture, and also democracy. That is where it begins. This is a free world now.
Okay. Now, Mr. Milton, just about the issue of corruption and accountability. Most recent has been the story about the Bank of Uganda.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Where we have had a couple of challenges. Particular personalities have failed to account for particular monies. We had previously also people from the Ministry of Finance also yes. having to fail. Previously, we also had people from police.
Yes.
Now, this kind of failure to account
yes.
or
yes.
terrible or decayed accountability yes. measures
yes.
and behavior in public service, vis-a-vis the efforts of publics, the civil society.
Yes.
Of course, we appreciate your suggestions about families and all this. But in my opinion, maybe
yes.
also lastly for you to comment,
yes.
that don't you think some things are better said as they are
yes.
than maybe dilly-dallying about how being family? And because, as a matter of fact, this is a fact.
Yeah.
When you go to hospitals, Ugandans are dying.
Yeah.
When you look at the health sector, mothers yes. are dying giving birth. Children die in hospitals because lack of medication and all these things.
Yes.
And this is what civil society is saying.
Yes.
But we have a challenge of accountability in
yeah.
the country.
Yes.
And this is steered by leaders. By the yeah. way, topmost leaders of
yeah.
this government
yeah.
have shied away from accountability.
Yeah, yeah.
And even though it was you,
yes.
Newton, who speaks about someone not accounting, people will say, you don't like government.
Yeah.
This has been the challenge of civil society. So, in a nutshell, I would want you to give your last words to people in civil society, people in government, particularly
yeah.
about accountability.
We need to account for everything. Because even if you refuse to account to Mr. President Museveni, you would account to God one day. All these thieves are going. I said it 4 years ago in this television. The thieves are going. The mafias we are talking about are going.
In
Do
government.
You know what? They are going from government. They have no space in government. And I am telling you, until we love to know these two things, patriotism, loving your country.
Exactly.
The mafias in this government are going. And I'm telling you, it was worse than this 4 years ago. We have been in the fight, on the ground, working with several leaders. The mafias who are left now in the government ministries have no space. They must be packing their goods now, their properties, and leave. Otherwise, the systems, look at the accountability systems that have been built in every ministry now. Right now, next year, all of those systems of accountability, individual and also institution, are not going to leave anybody without... people who are clean are going to remain in the ministries. I trust NRM government, the system that they have launched, is going to leave them. I only call upon all civil servants to love their country,
surely.
To love your neighbor, to love your work, to actually do something that can be remembered. Don't work to just for your stomach. Look at these people with big bellies. They are building high, whatever. They are stealing money, but I have told them 4 years ago, now this is the fourth year. They are all leaving. Civil society is doing a good job on that.
Yeah, sure.
So you must continue, but also accelerate on grassroots, because the tap is still pouring a lot of water, that water from the family, from the education institutions. So I am happy that the First Lady has actually introduced moral education in schools. That has been our role as Global Peace Foundation. And as per me, I really congratulate myself, because for the last 10 years, that has been my focus. Moral education, ethical culture, and entrepreneurship skills development in schools.
Okay.
So I thank your viewers, all of us. I thank all of you. Definitely be the watch of your neighbor. Be the watch of even the smallest money from the central government. Make sure from LOC1 you monitor government money. Report quickly, because this is our money.
Well,
so I thank you.
I wouldn't want to say it any better, but we must believe and trust that this is all our country, and we all own an equal share of it. Our biggest challenges and our biggest setback is because of corruption, or what my colleague is calling theft of public funds. We pray and hope that this vice, this disease, ends with you. Now, that has been it for us, me and Milton. Thank you, Milton, for this very vast discussion.
You,
now, we'll take a short break when Rowena will come back with another interview in GMU Agenda. Good morning.
kute kari kari yeah nga savinga kutata uyo wa free yeah kuspidi nga ya foki nga wengyoga njagala kari 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 yeah yeah.
The Airtel 4G smartphone is here, and now you can experience the real power of 4G speeds for just 200,000 shillings. And also get 5GB free data every month for 3 months and free 4G SIM card. Now that's value for your money. The Airtel 4G smartphone is available at authorized Airtel outlets countrywide.
Airtel, the smartphone network.
Mid-morning entertainment. We bring you the latest in showbiz.
He actually has already asked me for hand in for my hand in marriage way before I was even pregnant.
Topical issues.
So, as I told you, I want to become a business tycoon. Maybe I'll start with a restaurant.
Yeah.
Fashion, tech and gadget news, and your countdown. Join us Monday to Thursday, 10 a.m. Jam 101. We set the pace.
Talking about the best, I said my name is in Vogue.
This is yeah. From a day
your week with the best mid-morning the entertainment. We bring you the latest in showbiz.
He actually has already asked me for hand in for my hand in marriage way before I was even pregnant.
Topical issues.
So, as I told you, I want to become a business tycoon. Maybe I'll start with a restaurant.
Yeah.
Fashion, tech and gadget news, and your countdown. Join us Monday to Thursday, 10 a.m. Jam 101. We set the pace.
Talking about the best, I said my name is in Vogue.
This is
yeah.
From a day.
Good morning, Uganda. Rowena Kajumba here. With me in studios are two amazing gentlemen who are going to be talking with us and discussing the issue of our reading culture. I must say, we all agree that it has been quite a challenge over the years. But right next to me here is Bishop Herbert Buyondo. You're very welcome.
Thank you so much.
Indeed. And just a reminder that he's also an author and indeed part of the team here and partnering. Also at the extreme end there is Nasa Kakumba, who is the president of the Book Forum of Uganda. You're very welcome.
Thank you.
Now, this is an issue that for me is also very close at heart. But when we talk about the reading culture, some people may not really think it's important. But it's, we did have an earlier conversation before we went on set. And I must say, I've also discovered a few things. But first of all, what is the Book Forum?
Well, the Book Forum of Uganda is an NGO that is basically here to promote the reading and writing culture amongst Ugandans. So our role and mandate, if I may say, is to see to it that Ugandans embrace books. They read more and write more. Yes.
Very interesting. You're going to give me your story, but you
should. Yes.
Please, tell us more about your story. Tell us more about who you are as an author and what this means to you.
Okay. My name is Herbert Buyondo, as you've heard. I'm an author. As you've had, Bishop. I'm the Bishop of Kampala.
Yes.
And the born again faith of Uganda. And I pastor a local congregation called Victory in Namungona. That's West Kampala. I have been in this field, the book field, for some time. But I published several books, and there are challenges that we've been facing as publishers, I mean, as authors, as people that are in this field, simply because our reading culture is not that great. You'll appreciate this by, if I ask you a question, my sister, how many books have you read this year? Okay, let's come to 3 months ago.
3 months ago, I read about 5 books.
5 books?
Yeah.
Wow.
Reading one now, but yeah.
Okay, if I may ask you, instead of you asking me, what in among those books, what gives you much interest in reading?
I'm a lover of books. I love to read. I want to know stuff. So for me, when I learn something from one book, I'm, hey, I think I should find out from another.
Yeah. And you'll find that the more you read, the more benefits you get.
Yes.
Because I have a saying, you'll never get the details of me until you have read a book that I've written.
Oh, yeah, because the author's, so you sort of
spirit is depicted by what they write down. They put out, nobody will write anything stupid on a piece of paper that he wants to publish. They will write their best. Why? That means, but speaking, anybody can speak. Yeah. There are people who are called loud thinkers. Loud thinkers, they just talk. Pa, 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 pa. They think, but even if he's a loud thinker, when it comes to writing, they will think before they write. After writing, they read through. And that means if you read what they have written, you are getting the best out of them.
Yep.
That is what people should know. That before you listen to anybody, or before, when you listen to me, ask me my book. Then from there, you'll get more. Better than what I speak. Because what I speak is just on the top. The inside and the depth of what I'm talking about is in the book.
Indeed. So this question is going to go to both of you, but I'll start with you, Nasa. How long have you been in the business?
Well, I've been in this business for now 5 years, writing and publishing. Okay. I run a small publishing company in the names of Pan-African Publishers, and we've been publishing his works. Mm.
So you're the people.
Yeah, so we write, we do write and publish. So we also came up with this initiative to see to it that we take the writing to another level by promoting, you know, the writing, even amongst other Ugandans, because we believe that it's very important for the people to leave back, I mean, a trace. Like, if you've been a member of parliament for maybe 10 years, a minister for 15 years, you have something that you can write that can help other leaders. So we want to see to it that very many Ugandans embrace writing. And when we start writing, and when people start to read, we can, you know, have a lot of benefits out of that, because we get the information. And, you know, the word knowledge comes from know. Mm-hmm. So the more you know, the more knowledgeable you become. Mm-hmm. So, and you get to know by reading, by having a lot of information. So we really want to see to it that Ugandans have a lot of information. We can write a number of things about ourselves, about our history, about our businesses, mm-hmm. about a lot of things.
Indeed. Yep. How has this experience been, though? Because if we're looking at 5 years, mm-hmm. you must have a story.
True, I do. It's a process, and yeah. we appreciate and in fact, it's what has kept us going. Mm-hmm. The reading culture in Uganda, I may say, is low. But the signs of it increase. I mean, the signs of it growing. Mm-hmm. So we appreciate the fact that we've been seeing results. Mm-hmm. Ugandans are slowly and slowly accepting and appreciating writing and reading. And when you look at the bookshops that we have in Kampala, for instance, you find so many books written by Ugandans. Now we have a task to see to it that we promote. Mm-hmm. The readers, because the writers at least, you know, increasing in number.
Okay. And now, 5 years ago, today, mm-hmm. and now,
yep.
what is that you're seeing that has changed and improved?
The number of authors have increased, because last year, for instance, when we were organizing the Uganda Book Awards, mm-hmm. we had 16 categories of books written by Ugandans. And we were to have 5 nominees her category, but you would realize that the books were few. Mm-hmm. We were looking out for books which were not in the market then. Mm-hmm. But now, a year down the road, we have 21 categories.
Oh, wow.
And you realize that there is growth. People are embracing writing. The pastors are writing, mm-hmm. academicians are writing, young people are writing, and I think it's good for the country.
Mm-hmm. So, Bishop,
yes.
Pretty much the same process we've gone through with you. Mm-hmm. How long have you been?
I would say approximately 6 years.
Oh, wow.
5 years, but approximately 6 years.
Mm-hmm.
And my first book I wrote was about my life, mm-hmm. called Hope and Despair.
Mm-hmm.
Hope and Despair, the story of an African mm-hmm. preacher.
That's a good one.
And I want to take it to another level,
mm-hmm.
of doing a movie out of it.
That's
because simply because I was frustrated by the reading culture.
Yeah.
And somebody advised me to take it to a level of doing a movie out of it, because
so it's easy to take on.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a movie, you know, somebody can watch it and enjoy it,
mm-hmm.
but when you read, it gives you a lot of depth,
mm-hmm.
into where you think more. The difference between reading and watching, people these days prefer watching.
True.
Seeing and listening than reading. But reading is more profitable than watching.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if people can take it.
I get what you're saying, because mm-hmm. when I was younger, the things I used to hear,
yes.
without necessarily seeing,
mm-hmm.
are things that till now,
yes.
you know, come back at me, and I remember.
They stick.
And I think, and you know, it brings. It's like reading. You're creating your own sins.
Exactly. Exactly.
Mm.
You create that picture.
Mm.
The picture you create is not the picture they have created for you,
mm-hmm.
because he who has created that picture thought about it,
indeed,
and then created it for you.
You get the point.
Yes.
And he writes down the script. Mm-hmm. After writing that script, then he writes down the sceneries and all that. Mm-hmm. But if you read it, you can create your own picture, and that picture will never go away.